Good morning. I'd like to say what an illuminating keynote that was, both exciting and hopeful. I'd like to welcome you to the next session, our first session of the morning, A New View. And we have two speakers, very pioneering speakers, this morning in understanding single molecules, molecular interactions, and their mechanisms, and how that translates to cells, tissues, and to whole systems. Our first speaker is Professor Xiaowei Zhang from Harvard. She's the David B. Arnold Professor of Science, and she's the Director of Science Advanced Imaging at Harvard University. She's also an investigator of the Howard Hughes Medical Institute. She's developed many new technologies. She's pioneered these in understanding and imaging single molecules and invented at least two technologies, including STORM and MERFISH. She has many awards, too many of them to speak about today, but I would like to say she's a member of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences and a MacArthur Fellow. Today she's going to speak to you about illuminating biology at the nanoscale and system scale and using single molecule and super resolution imaging. So please welcome Professor Zhang.
Wow, it's really a great pleasure to be here, and I would like to start by thanking the organizers, Phil, Susan, and Tyler for the kind invitation, and for Angie for the kind introduction. So, as Angela has said, we develop imaging methods to study biological systems. And today I've chosen to speak about a couple of relatively more recent imaging technologies that we've developed to study to actually image single cell transcriptome and the three-dimensional organization of the genome. So I have to say that I was particularly happy after hearing Eric Lander's talk that I felt like I chose the right subject to study. So, so basically, I want to say up front that these technologies, we've just begun to apply them to study cancer systems. So I apologize that you won't hear about anything about our study of cancer because it's too premature to talk about, but hopefully you can appreciate that these methods can be applied to study cancer systems. So let me start by saying that we all know, especially after Eric's talk, that inside the cell, it's not just a couple of genes, but it's actually thousands of different genes and molecular species that are at work and interact in really intricate interaction networks and collectively give the cell its specific behavior. And imaging has known to be really an excellent tool to directly visualize these molecular interactions. And in particular, if we think about fluorescence microscopy, and thanks to its molecular specificity, we can really look at molecular processes and interactions inside the cell. And also traditionally, the resolution of light microscopy limited by diffraction has been a hindrance for us to look at these molecular interactions. But thanks to the recent development of super resolution tools, we know that this barrier has been overcome, and we are really approaching molecular scale resolution when look at this molecular, these molecular interactions inside the cell. Now, however, there is some disadvantages of the imaging, imaging methods. And it's traditionally, a relatively low throughput approach. By that, what I meant is we typically use that to look at one gene or a few genes at a time by looking by taking sort of multicolor images and see these beautiful green, red, and magenta structures interacting with each other. And it would really be great, if we could actually also image all these molecules together so that we could also use imaging to get a systems view of how cell and tissue and whole body works. So in other words, we would like to have this genomic scale throughput too also for imaging methods. And so that's what my focus of the talk will be. And so with that, I want to say that we set out to develop these tools starting from the molecule RNA, and that is both for biological reasons and for practical reasons that you will see very quickly. But biologically, as we know that, you know, cell has a lot of different types, as Eric had just mentioned, and very different behavior and function, but their genome are largely similar. And it's primarily the gene expression profile of different types of cells, a different gene expression profile of different types of cells that give their specific behavior. So it would be really great if we could quantify the gene expression profile or the transcriptome of individual cells. That really could go a long way to help us understand the molecular origin of different cellular behavior. And indeed, powerful techniques such as single-cell RNA-seq has already begun to transform many areas of biology, as you will hear later today from Aviv Regev's talk. So then why do we want to develop an imaging-based approach to study the transcriptome? And there are a variety of advantages, but here I just want to emphasize one single word that's spatially resolved. And as we know that inside the cells, RNAs are not really uniformly distributed, and their non-uniform or local distribution and local translation is actually a very important form of post-transcriptional regulation. And it is important for the establishment and maintenance of local cellular structures, and synaptic plasticity being one good example. And also at another level, inside the body or tissue, we heard that there are many different types of cells. These cells are also not randomly distributed, and their spatial organization is also important for the tissue function. So imagine we could not dissociate these cells from the tissue, but directly in situ measure the transcriptome of these cells and then determine their cell types. And then we could directly visualize the spatial organization of these cell types in the tissue, see how they interact and together with the give the tissue its function. So that's why we're interested in developing a single-cell transcriptome imaging method. And there are, of course, different ways to do that. For example, you could use in situ sequencing approach. And the approach that we use is based on single molecule fluorescence in situ hybridization, or single molecule FISH, which is a truly powerful approach pioneered by Rob Singer and optimized by Singer, Arjun Raj, and others into a highly quantitative approach, which means you could image individual RNA molecules, see their locations inside the cell, and count their copy numbers with extraordinarily high precision. However, the challenge of transcriptome imaging is that a transcriptome contains not just a few different kinds of RNAs, but several thousands, if not tens of thousands, of different kinds of RNAs. So you certainly don't have that many colors to put together to image these thousands to tens of thousands of species. So how do you approach this problem? So several years ago, we came up with the idea of using combinatorial labeling and sequential imaging to image almost, in principle, an unlimited number of different RNA species inside the cell. So this plot looks a little complicated, but the method is actually not that hard to understand. So here is a simple view of it. So we actually encode these different RNA species with unique binary codes, and then we label them with a combination or library of oligos to imprint these binary codes onto these RNAs. And then we actually address these binary codes, read out them one bit at a time using sequential imaging. So for example, in the first round of imaging, we address or label or image those RNAs. Their first bit reads one, but not zero. And then we turn them off. And then in the second round, we label and image those RNAs. Their second bit reads one, but not zero. And so on and so forth, like images like this. So then at the end of imaging, what you get is lots and lots and lots of individual dots inside the cell. Each individual dot corresponds to a single RNA molecule, and each one has a string of binary code word associated with it. Depends on which round it turned on, hence reads that one, and which one round it didn't turn on and reads zero. So then how many different kinds of RNA species can we address in a single image like that becomes a pretty simple mathematical problem. And that is for n-bit binary code, how many different code words there are. And even without a strong mathematical background, you would know this number immediately. That's 2 to the n. And that's really a powerful number because even just imaging 16-bit, or in a simple way, use 16 rounds of imaging, you will be able to actually simultaneously image 65,000 RNAs. And of course, I choose 16 specifically because 65,000 or 60,000 is around the whole transcriptome size, including both coding and non-coding RNAs. So you know, this is really great, right? Except that this picture is just a bit too rosy to be true. And one proof of that is when we published this first paper on this technique, we did not image 65,000 RNAs. So there are a number of challenges. One major challenge is the error propagation problem. So as I have already mentioned, that single molecule FISH is a really highly accurate approach. What that means is if you image a single RNA species, count its copy number with a single molecule FISH image, you can have really high accuracy, better than that 95%. So less than 5% error. Nonetheless, this error will propagate when you image multiple bits. So after two rounds of imaging, 5% could become 10%, after three rounds, become 15%. And after 16 rounds of imaging, you could actually have a quite substantial portion of your RNA misidentified. So I always say this to say that, you know, if I tell you that, oh, I imaged all these cells in a big piece of chunk of tissue, and I identified individual cells transcriptome, all of it, and then I give it to you, and then you can mine it and learn everything, right? And then you get very excited. And then if I add a sentence to say, oh, by the way, several tenths of percent of the RNAs are misidentified, and you could imagine your response to me, right, to, you know, get out of here. So how do you solve this problem? So we solve this problem actually by borrowing a trick that at MIT, you would particularly, I think you would particularly know very well, because this is a trick that is coming from a pretty far distant field, which I'm glad that I'm speaking at the Convergence Symposium, because you can see how different fields can really converge. So this is a trick used in the digital communication world a lot. And because we know that these days, the text messages, emails, and so on, these are all transmitted with binary code words, and we rarely get any garbled messages. And that is because they don't just use a simple binary code. They use what's so-called error-robust encoding system. A simple way to understand it is you don't use all possible binary words. You use a subset of it that between valid codes, multiple errors has to occur. And for example, one of the most efficient error-robust encoding system or codes is called Hamming code. Now, if the Hamming distance is 4, that means 4 errors has to simultaneously occur in one message in order to convert it into another valid message. Now, with that, of course, you could immediately understand that you would drive the misidentification rate to a much smaller number. And indeed, with a realistic calculation of the FISH error, the misidentification error dropped from tens of percent to just several percent. And moreover, because if its Hamming distance is 4, if we actually have one error occur, we can not only detect that, we can even correct that, because it's uniquely close to one correct code, and then at least 3 errors away from the other code. So with this correction, we can also increase the detection efficiency. And finally, we realized that FISH has a asymmetric error. So 1 to 0 and 0 to 1 error occurs with different frequency, so we further modified the code to have constant small number of one to further decrease the misidentification rate and increase the detection efficiency. So that's why we call this method multiplexed error robust fluorescence in situ hybridization, or MRFISH. And then here's just a simple, well, I apologize, the slide is not simple, illustration of labeling approach for that. So we label it with combination of oligos that has readout sequences. And these readout sequences are exactly determined by their code. And then we come out with probes, hybridization probes, to read out these bits one at a time. So then here's an experimental validation. So basically, using a 16-bit modified Hamming distance 4 code that we came up with, that we can encode 140 genes, and this is a typical single-cell image with many different RNAs, their color coding for their RNA species, and here are two different validations. We can compare that with the gold standard in the field. Again, you do single-molecule FISH, but then, of course, we compare that for a subset of genes. 15 of them span three orders of magnitude in abundance, all the way to actually the low abundance level of less than one per cell, and we can get basically perfect agreement, and then also compare with bulk sequencing, very high correlation. And then I mentioned, you know, multiple rounds of hybridization. Of course, the simplest way of thinking about imaging a 16-bit code is 16 rounds of hybridization, but you really don't need that many rounds, because you could use multiple colors to image multiple bits at a time. So with two-color imaging, eight rounds of hybridization, or four-color imaging and only four rounds of hybridization, we could address all 140 genes this way. And then here are two experimental measures of the properties. We have a detection efficiency of nearly 100%. Which is really an important advantage of this kind of imaging or FISH-based approach, because that allow us to detect pretty rarely expressed genes or low abundance genes, so which can be very important for determining the cell type or cell behavior with very high accuracy. And the misidentification rate, as I promised, is indeed low. And we can not only image 100 genes, we can also image many more. So here's a demonstration of 1,000 genes, which we can use either longer codes, or sometimes if you don't care about getting this extraordinarily high detection efficiency, you could also use error robust code that has a lower Hamming distance number, 2, which would only allow you to detect error but not correct error. With that, even 14-bit would encode 1,000 genes, and here's an experimental demonstration of that, which we still get very high correlation with bulk sequencing. But you can see that compared with the Hamming distance 4 code, we still have high correlation but lower detection efficiency, and that is about one-third of the detection efficiency, as I previously mentioned, which still means 30% detection efficiency, which still compares quite well with a single-cell RNA-seq approach. So this is the first demonstration of a transcriptome scale single-cell RNA profiling by multiplexed FISH. And we're actually not the only labs that appreciate this kind of power of imaging-based gene expression profiling approach. There are other labs working on that as well. For example, Long Kai's lab has independently developed a different a multiplexed FISH method, and recently demonstrated imaging also of a few hundred genes was his approach. And then also I want to say that multiplexed FISH approach is also not the only kind of approach that can do this. I mentioned already in situ sequencing, as demonstrated by George Church and here at Harvard Medical School, and Mats Nielsen in Sweden. And also, RNA is not the only kind of approach you could do that. You could also imagine imaging many different kinds of proteins together to give you this gene expression profile, as what, for example, Gary Nolan at Stanford has been doing. So then, in the remaining time, I want to actually give several examples of what we can apply this to. And I see I'm running behind in time, so let me skip two of them and then get to this one that I've already mentioned quite a number of times. That is, we could use this approach to in situ determining different types of cells and their spatial organization. And of course, for that, we need to be able to use this approach to actually measure not just a monolayer of culture cells, but image directly tissue slices with a high performance. And indeed, we can do that. And not only that, we can actually image with truly high throughput of a tenth of thousands of cells just in an overnight experiment, and actually a pretty cheap way. So this method, the running cost is only a small fraction of that of actually sequencing approach. So with that, for example, we applied to an area of brain tissue and imaged 160 genes. And then here I'm just showing you several different gene signatures to show you that you can indeed see different distributions of those. And then with that, then we can group cells into different clusters, presumably corresponding to different types of cells or different states of cells, and see their spatial organization. And in this preliminary work about a brain tissue imaging. And then here I want to plug in, of course, this would be applicable to look at a tumor, which is such a heterogeneous environment with many different types of cancer cells and normal cells, immune cells, and so on, interacting with each other. So with this approach, then we can see these different types of cells and see how they interact in tumor, which is what we begun to work on. And Eric has mentioned that, and I see Corey sitting there about this new initiative of human cell atlas. And of course, we're very interested in applying this approach to the human cell atlas determination. And the next application that I want to mention. Interestingly, again, following Eric's talk, it makes it quite simple, and that is we could actually apply this to high throughput screening. And then screening is such a powerful tool these days to find out which genes is responsible for which kind of behavior, and then how do you actually vary the proteins and then get different desired properties, such as drug development and so on. And then the screening approaches often use a very high throughput, simple to implement methods, such as fact sorting and so on. But there are a lot of phenotypes that you want to screen. It would require imaging-based studies to do that. But high throughput imaging-based screening is difficult because after you image the phenotype, select the phenotype, it's hard to harvest that cell and then find its genotype. And we think Merfish can help. Actually, I want to demonstrate here that Merfish indeed can help by actually expressing the gene variants or the gene activation or inhibition agents such as CRISPR-I together with a barcode into the same cells. And then, there's thousands of or millions of cells expressing each individual one expressing a different kind of a phenotype, and then have a unique barcode associated with it. And then we can image the phenotype afterwards using Merfish to read out the barcode, and then we can build the genotype to phenotype correspondence. And then I want to illustrate here with a simple application of trying to evolve a recently developed fluorescent protein that only becomes fluorescent after binding a ligand, and then using this approach. And then this is a pretty powerful kind of a protein if it only becomes fluorescent by binding a ligand. And then the problem of this protein is it's relatively dim and it bleaches pretty fast with a pretty pronounced fast bleaching component. And then after using our Merfish-based high-throughput image-based screening approach, we actually screened 60,000 different mutants. And then here is actually the original one. And you can see we can find both brighter ones and the one basically eliminated its fast photobleaching component, as you can see here with several examples, was the fast bleaching component indeed eliminated. And in the final remaining couple of minutes, I just want to extend this approach to image not only RNA, but also DNA. And again, Eric has mentioned that the three-dimensional organization of the genome these days, we know it's very important for gene regulation. and other genome functions. So we imagine that MERFISH-based approach can also help to get this kind of a 3D organization of the genome. And then how does it do that? You know, if we just, I just remind you what MERFISH does for RNA, it identifies thousands of different RNA species and localize them in the cell. Just imagine to change these RNA species into genomic loci. Then you can localize them, identify them, localize them, and then we can then trace the backbone of the genome and then get the 3D organization. And here's a simple demonstration of that where we can see, you know, if we label the whole chromosome simultaneously, you can get a blob. But if we image a few loci at a time, determine their location, and then using sequential imaging, and eventually we can get this kind of a 3D organization of the genome, which gives you a much more enriched information of its structure. And then here's just a one last data slide to actually demonstrate one application. And we know from pioneering Hi-C studies that the genome or the chromosome is partitioned into compartments. So the actively transcribed genes tend to be in one compartment, the other in another compartment called compartment A and B. But in this, you don't know whether from the Hi-C study, whether they're just having higher frequency of interactions or whether they truly separate into physical compartments. And if they do, what kind of a spatial organization? Are they side by side or circular? Let me skip this part just by showing this, that when we look at individual chromosomes, so we can see that these active and inactive genomic loci are really segregated into spatial compartments that are arranged side by side. And then we see that for many individual copies of chromosome 21, chromosome 22, chromosome 20, and so on. So was that, then you could imagine that using super resolution approach, which we demonstrated to give you a much higher resolution compared to fluorescence conventional imaging study to see genomic loci shape and combined with sequential imaging, then we can actually get a high resolution map of the 3D organization of the genome. And then when combined with transcriptome imaging, we can see how the 3D organization of the genome can regulate gene expression and so on. So with that, let me just conclude by thanking the true heroes who has done all this work. And the MERFISH development is really thanks to a number of talented people, a postdoc, Jeff Moffitt in the lab, together with Alistair Bedecker and Kao-Kao Chen. And some of the more recent development is a collaboration between Jeff Moffitt, Guiping Wang, George Hao, George Emmanuel, Tian Lu, and the chromosome imaging work is largely due to Stephen Wan, another talented postdoc in the lab in collaboration with Junhan Su. And the high resolution work is Bogdan Bingtu and Alistair Bedecker. And our brain tissue MERFISH is a really wonderful collaboration with my friend and colleague, Catherine Duluc at Harvard MCB. And the chromatin imaging work is in collaboration with Ting Wu at Harvard Medical School and Leonid Murney at MIT here. And the work is supported by Hughes and NIH. And I would like to thank you for your attention.